two sessions have, you know, which covered Android in some from the programming, you know, area. So we felt that why not we cover the concepts rather than programming. Programming can be, you know, by looking at the developer's manual or things like that. But concepts are actually more important. So then we decided, so our challenging guys around 11 to 12, so they have taken a challenge that they will finish almost everything of Android what is there. They had very limited time, which was like 3-4 days only to prepare on all of this. Right? Am I right? Or more? 3-4 days. So this is a little mix of, is not just, so this is a little mix of different things and internals of the OS itself, but we are not covering Linux 2.6 because it is well known that it is, the documentation is fairly available almost everywhere. I mean, there are good books on 2.6, and Android we did not find any good books, or there is much, not so much as 2.6 of Linux which you will find, or maybe you have to, like, you know, hunt the code, you know, open and dissect it and then do some appropriate operations on it. So there were a bunch of different areas from where, and then this was the stack we were actually following. So we are trying to cover the whole stack. I don't know how much is going to get covered, but at least to some extent we are touching every area. So apart from Android, so we are also covering some energy applications which are dependent on, you know, all applications which take more energy. Certain applications take more energy. Certain, now if you are talking of low power devices, energy becomes very critical. So you need to take care of energy in such scenario, because you may not want the device to be off after 2-3 hours. You may want the device to function for pretty long time, 5 hours. So how can we see these are the issues which are there? Can we solve some problems in that area? So Anjali will be actually presenting that. So there is one invited presentation. I felt this is important because you all like Facebook and Orkut, and there are many, right? Twitters and all. So all of the technology which is used there, you know, to understand, they are not the same as what it was 4 years back or 5 years back. They changed dramatically. Now in connection to Android, can we see that such data? I was actually dreaming about connecting, say, 1 million Android tablets to convert 1 million Android tablets into a supercomputer. Because if you see such a small device, a small board, which is costing, I think it is around $40. So around $20 would be the cost of the board. I think the more cost goes for that LCD, which is a capacitive touchscreen. So if you actually see the supercomputers which are there, say 10 to 15 years back, the board that they had is comparable to the board that you have now here, like this. So that's the power that you have now. So why not even think of doing, you know, like, you know, having such a large scale, you know, on the fly connecting systems wherein you can avail the power of such system and use for high computations, like in high performance computing or CFDs, like, you know, computational fluid dynamics, or there are many, like simulations, aerospace simulations or anything like that, you know, which requires enormous amount of computational power. Your machine cannot do that, small machines. So I was thinking about that, and but still it is not the same as Hadoop and Bigtable and Hives and whatever. So they are slightly different, but then you can see the shift that has happened, you know, the paradigm shift that has happened from the times that we have been using databases were structured, you know, schema oriented, highly schema oriented, and now there is no schema. The schema is to be inferred. That is what these people do, Facebook and Google or Yahoo or any of these people. The beginning with the first presentation we'll have by Rajesh, that is embedded operating systems. Operating systems which are tiny, not like massive as Microsoft operating system, Windows or to that matter this Linux-based operating system, Unix operating systems. So which are tiny and which are very which require good faster response because they are to be ported on smaller devices. And now if you consider the real-time aspects of certain operating systems, right? So if you then your monolithic kernel, which is there, the Linux kernel 2.6 and above, which are monolithic, they do not perform that well. So real-time applications do require different operating systems. And I was thinking that, or many of us were thinking that nowadays everybody wants in real time. Then why not use real-time operating system on such devices? I think we want everything in real time, right? So fast. It's not that we want to wait and we are happy with what we have. We want something faster. So why not use a real-time operating system rather than Android? Android is not real time. It's not real time. So Muse is in real time. So he's not covering real time. I thought he would cover. So there are a bunch of RTOS, real time OSs, RTOS, then you're not covering. But there are many. I think in the L4. Alpha, looking things from a different aspect rather than not taking what people are giving us. You know, that is what we are trying to see whether we can think better in a different way rather than working the same way that people have, you know, given us this code and that code and which is coming right in the system. Something different. And then kernel driver, this will be quite interesting because a lot of things that Nimit will be touching on, and he'll almost cover the major section of the driver part, and the major section itself is a binder interface. Then on 17 June, we'll be having something on security issues. So one of the M.Tech students will be covering the security issues right in Android, not anywhere else, right inside Android. What are the problems? Why this OS does have a problem? Rather, I mean, like, so there are certain inherent problems because the design of the system itself, the operating system design itself, or the wrappers, or the way the binder interface or the RPCs are actually being used in this system, this Android system. So now you can see the flaws in the system design itself, and then maybe you can look at the enhancement to your system. So deep study is required. You know, it's not a one day affair or one hour that you can do anything. It will take maybe 1 year or 2 years to think, but you know, to understand these issues, you need to go inside the kernel to open it up, see where is the loophole, you know, and all of these things. And those loopholes which have already been identified, you know, expose them, and then do a lot of algorithmic, you know, computationally, you can, you know, keep on verifying the system. There are verification methods available, you know, wherein you can actually verify an OS. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with this. What is that? I always forget. Functional programming languages. Functional programming? No. functional. Haskell, you heard of Haskell?
Scheme, yes.
ML, Haskell. So you will be surprised that Haskell was used to actually verify a real-time operating system. Why would they not use C or C++ to do that? You might have not heard that, outside nobody talks about functional programming languages. But if you go in the R&D sections of the bigger companies, you will find such things happening. And Haskell is used, I think, almost more than 50% of the different companies that you see, big companies. I'm not talking of small companies, who are all established companies. So they have, I don't remember which company it was, but they verified the operating system using Haskell. And that was surprising. So, coming back to the security issues, you know, he'll be looking at different places where, so he will not go and open the code. So he will look at some papers of which he has come across and then expose it to you also, that you can also get benefited. Or maybe tomorrow you want to do some project in security, I mean, an Android security or something like that. So, One thing that that is, you know, like what I feel is more important, rather than, you know, like just doing a two month summer internship, is actually a small course, just not enough. There must be something common, you know, like a mailing list or somewhere, you know, wiki. So projects getting put up on such wikis, and then you know, updates happening at such places where you get good material to read, or directions to go and do some good work, not essentially the final year project, but you know, getting to know things rather than just doing for the sake of doing a project. In fact, many people do that. That's motivation. They say motivation for writing thesis is to do but the motivation for writing thesis is always different. The motivation for writing thesis comes from the scenarios or very exciting examples that you can give and which require more attention. So that is motivating. But for some people, motivation is doing thesis or getting a grade. So anyway, I was thinking, you know, if you can have a common repository somewhere, you know, pushing contents, good contents, you know, not just flooding, but some minimal content required or some direction, you know, for a particular topic, you know, what are the papers, research papers you can read and things like that, go after one another, so you get a clear direction right in the beginning, something like that, rather than just do summer internship and go. That's not good enough, right? There must be something, yes. Or maybe like, you know, take the Akash tablet itself along with you when you go and then start working on it. So then Anshita Agarwal, she's not here, I think she'll be sure. That's on 17th actually. So we are covering authentication mechanisms on Android. So we are not sure how much what is available on it, but in general she's going to cover authentication mechanism and then look into Android, what is exactly there, right? So another interesting one which is going to happen is Dalvik virtual machine and the comparison, and the Java virtual machine, how they are different. One is stack based, one is register based. Sun and who is the other fellow, Google, they are fighting. They are saying that Java is faster. Google is saying Android is faster. Dalvik is faster. But traditionally, if you look at the stack-based machine, it has to be slower. It cannot be faster. But Java, some people claim that it is faster. That is also possible. We don't know, because internally how it is designed, So it takes lot of time to actually understand all this thing. Why this is faster, why that is slower and all that. We don't know. Certain scenario it may be faster. For certain scenario it may be slower. So the virtual machines, how they are different and, you know. So it's quite interesting to go inside and see so many things right there. And one person cannot do everything of this. That's a problem. So that's why I said, why not take many people and do all this. In fact, one story. I read 100 books in five hours. It's quite interesting. You would be surprised. 100 books in 5 hours. Can anybody tell me how?
Index.
Huh? Index. Now I know what you do. They were smart and intelligent people. Five of them. Each of them had read 20 books. I had a discussion with them for 5 hours. Rigorous discussion. And finished reading all 100 books. That is what you are going to get today. In this, whatever, you know, whatever they have spent for 3, 4 days or 5 days, you'll get in one hour. Like that. So, and then Android application framework, which will be done by Ravi. Pawan will take up the educational applications, but he will not exactly take the educational applications which are available, or I mean, I don't know what he's doing, but I feel that he would be doing something like this, that is looking at what educational applications could be beneficial for the society. I mean for students who are in higher education or engineering sections. So what is that, you know, the mindset is different. Actually, student mindset is different. The engineering students, they have different way of looking at applications. Their way of access is also different, right? So he I think probably should be focusing on that, in that aspect. So I hope you get some good material there. Yeah, because I am still doubtful as to what. But if you look at OLI, which is Online Learning Initiative, or in fact the OLI itself, that is CMU's, Carnegie Mellon University, they have been doing it for last 50 years. 50 years experimentation. Just to know what is there in his brain. I mean, not yours, but you know, just the psychology of a person. Is he really learning or not? Is he just sitting and smiling here? So trying to understand, you know, and then, you know, they have some control groups, an experimental group. So then they relate to each other, saying that, okay, that experimental group is doing well. So the experimental group is something which is using the latest technology for education, I mean for learning, like applications or like virtual chemistry. Some of you may be doing virtual chemistry, right? So virtual chemistry, that or applets, many people are doing applets here, I know. So then comparing whether this applet, what you are devising, you know, what you are making, you know, this applet, is it really going to give a student enough information from this applet? This is a question. Unless until you highlight the, you know, the way of interaction. This is normally called as the human computer interaction. If you want to do research to know whether this thing is going to give enough benefit to somebody, you know, in this context, then human computer interaction. Computer is here, human is here. That's the interaction. And now you abstract it out and then find out what are the different patterns that a human accesses that device. What ways? Does it want faster? Does it want slower? You know, at what frequency? So there are many, many things. So there's another department here which is doing that, which is IDC. So they have a course, which they have one area which is human computer interaction, like that. So you can actually look things in many, many different ways and find answers in many, there are many solutions to it. Not one perfect solution. There's nothing like that. There's no one perfect solution for anything of this. So it's not 2 plus 2 equals 4. after some time 2 plus 2 becomes 22. So when you are small, 2 plus 2 is 4. When you grow up, then 2 plus 2 become maybe 6, I don't know. And then when you grow higher, 2 plus 2 becomes 22, or it becomes infinity. So there are a bunch of things that they are going to cover, and then we will have an interactive session. Of course, I will be helping him whenever he's going to be in trouble, or he can carry on, because I think he is having the potential. You have to show your kinetic energy now.